So that is the power of technology which actually can help. Health insurance premiums have grown from 741 crores in 2001-2 to 17,620 crores by financial year ending March 2014. By 2020, it's expected to be 50,000 crore market. 60% of the market share is, as of today, of the public sector insurance companies and 40% of private insurance companies. The industry is expected to grow at a rate of 15 to 18% for the next 5 to 6 years. However, the growth in the retail sector is still very low. A major portion has been corrections in the group health premiums. The potential for growth is very high, but for insurance companies, the business is still a loss-making business. Very few insurance companies, hardly 2 or 3 are making. The loss ratios have been around 100% on just premiums to claims and combined ratios when I talk about intermediary costs as well as that is the cost of acquisition or cost of management, it is around 120. Then you would say that why are they doing it? It is because they are cross-subsidizing it over other lines of business because it is being done by a general insurance company. The moment standalone health insurance companies start increasing their business, they have to do it on a profit. They don't have anywhere to cross-subsidize this business. Now, let us look at evolution of health insurance. Indemnity, hospitalization cover only. That is, if a person today, that is where we are in majority, where a person gets admitted to a hospital, his hospitalization cost is covered the moment he's out of hospital, some pre and post-hospitalization treatment. Next comes is indemnity, all expenses, where you indemnify a person for all expenses, whether it is outpatient, inpatient, etc., or preventive care, and then you go on to managed care, where you manage the care, you start from wellness programs, preventive care, etc., to ensure that there are the person is kept healthy so that the risk of hospitalization and the cost of hospitalization gets reduced. Today, unfortunately, we are still in indemnity hospitalization basis only. All our products from the first policy before nationalization of health, I mean the insurance industry, in 72, there were private insurance companies who were offering group health insurance to corporates. Then there was a nationalization period. 1986, the first medical policy got introduced by the public sector companies. But still today, what you are having is a variant of the same. We are still not covering outpatient treatment. We are not still covering a comprehensive health. It's not a comprehensive health insurance. Hospital and medical expenses insurance, that is, that's what I was talking about. Comprehensive coverage, outpatient, dental, prescription, drugs, etc., and managed care. Why? Today, our healthcare sector is such that we are not able to introduce this into the market. We cannot give an outpatient treatment coverage. We are not able to have, we don't have organized outpatient clinics, or organized diagnostic centers. There's something called medical savings account. This is a product which started, actually originated in Singapore, but then caught over in places like in US and rest of the world. It's something where a person is allowed tax-free deductions and a medical saving account is created where he keeps on, just like a provident fund, he keeps on putting in deductions into it. He gets a tax-free deduction and that takes care of smaller medical expenses. So he is utilizing his own money for his treatment. So he's going to be judicious in doing that. And he buys a cover which is a top-up cover to this particular thing which covers major medical expenses. This is something which we are also looking at introducing subject to certain regulatory changes and certain tax. Government has to come in for it. Wellness initiatives, insurance companies have started something, but it's still a long way to go. Benefit products, you have critical illness or dread disease covers, hospital cash where you talk about critical illness covers, there is a list of 12 critical illnesses where, or 10 critical illnesses. First time diagnosis, you pay the full sum insured amount. hospital cash is for per day of hospitalization, you pay something. Disability income insurance provides payment when the insured is unable to work as a result of sickness or injury. In India, we are still having only injury, not due to sickness, again due to certain different reasons. So there are a lot of, we are still in the hospitalization coverage area. We still have to move a lot ahead. Distribution of health insurance is through agents, individual and corporate, brokers, corporate or agents, individual means individual agents and corporate agents. Brokers, again, corporate brokers as well as retail brokers who sell retail policies, those are retail brokers. Bank assurance is a channel of distribution through single window channel. Through banks, you start distributing. Direct marketing, telemarketing or feet on street, web sales, and new innovative channels are there to come. Impact of health insurance on the healthcare sector. Growth of health insurance is an opportunity to improve healthcare standards, especially healthcare infrastructure and accessibility to quality care. Will promote uniform standards of healthcare access across the length and breadth of the country. Success or failure of any health insurance program depends largely upon the network and quality of healthcare providers. And there's an immediate demand for such facilities. Can help remove urban bias and help develop healthcare infrastructure in rural areas. RSPY is a good example. One of these conferences, I think it was FICCI or CIA, one doctor said that I was working in a Delhi hospital earning salary and I didn't have money to start my own hospital in Delhi. But because of RSPY, I went back to my village in UP and I started with whatever money I had, I could start my own hospital. Today I'm owning my own hospital and doing my own business. That is the power which actually this type of schemes have given. People can go and practice in their area. Otherwise, in most of the cities you could see, or most of the places across the country, people have to come to district headquarters for availing treatment. Different and innovative products would become available. Growth of health insurance means increased standardized data resulting in greater use of information technology in healthcare sector. So automatically, IT in healthcare sector grows. There is a stimulated growth in pharma sector. Increased manpower requirements in healthcare and health insurance sector. Now we come back to the challenges. Areas to be addressed. Unregulated healthcare sector. Standardization of treatment guidelines. For the first time, I think, in the Clinical Establishment Act, there are 20 STGs which have been given. And this also, if I'm not mistaken, are the result of that FICCI committee where the medical fraternity did come forward and come out with STGs for 20 conditions. Variation in prices for same procedures across different hospitals in different cities. Variations in prices in same hospital for same procedure for different patients. Hospitals have separate pricing for insurance and non-insurance patients. Easy availability of drugs without prescription and prescriptions without consultations. Unethical practices across whatever, wherever all this. Now, for an insurance company to actually price a product, they require to know two things. One is the incidence rates, and second is the severity of the cost. When we are not able to assess cost correctly, it becomes very, very difficult. Whatever your actual pricing, estimates the cost, it still goes for a toss. This is one subject I'm just touching it and leaving it because I feel that it is maybe too early for India, or you are the best judge whether actually this can be done. Health outcomes, outcome measures for quality improvement. Indian accreditation agencies are now emphasizing on incident reports, mortality reports, morbidity reports, surgical site infection rates, rehospitalization rates. We don't have hospital grading in the country. Even NABH accreditation would be you are accredited or you are not. But today, Clinical Establishment Act does provide some sort of an gradation of hospitals. So today, as if an insurance company, what would the insurance companies want? They would want gradation of hospitals and costs related to those grades of hospitals and the type of treatments being given. For insurance, better evidence through outcome measures leads to proper profiling of providers. We would like to profile. Link payments to health outcome measures. Help to differentiate between supplier-induced demand and evidence-based practice. Compare effectiveness of procedure used. A high-cost procedure might reduce need for recurring hospitalizations. There is always a, do you require to use that type of a surgery or that type of a new development which may be one of the large multinational or somebody has come out with. There is always a debate. An insurance company may come up and say, no, I don't want to cover this because this is too costly. I don't want to cover it. But still, is it right in not covering? How do we decide on it? The effectiveness of procedure use, like high cost, we could always say a high cost procedure might reduce need for recurring hospitalizations. We today have a challenge where there's a lot of debate going on about robotic surgeries. If you ask my personal opinion, where it is required, it should be done, and I would be very happy to support it. If the surgery demands a lot of precision, neurosurgery or cardiac surgery or aortic surgery, where it demands precision, yes, it should be done. But the problem comes is, do you require it to be done for an appendectomy or cholecystectomy, or where it would cost traditionally or 40 or 50,000 rupees, a cholecystectomy would just be billed around 3.5 lakh rupees or 4 lakh rupees. Then you'll have to have products saying that, okay, this covered, you need to pay higher premium. Research outcomes on relationship between cost, quality and health outcome. I think this might have been covered earlier, but higher spending does not result in better quality of care. Higher spending also does not result in improved patient perceptions of the accessibility or quality of medical care and their experiences in the hospital. In a payment system where provider incomes depend upon the volume of services they provide, patients in regions with more physicians and hospital beds have more frequent visits to physicians and more hospitalizations. This is picked up from research papers, so this is where. What has the industry done? What has the health insurance industry or the insurance industry done? The regulator has taken a lot of steps. Health insurance regulations have come up. There are regulations for TPAs. There are policyholders protection regulations. Today, any complaint against the insurer or the TPA or anybody is being now, there is a mechanism put in by the regulator. Even all grievances which are reported to the companies have to get reported to the regulator, which are being monitored, and they are held to task. But that is where again we come in. Today there is no regulation in the healthcare sector. If there is a problem with a particular hospital or with a doctor, you don't know what to do, where to go. How do you address a problem with a hospital? Or if you have to resolve a dispute between a hospital and an insurance company, there is no third person who can actually come in to resolve other than litigations. The insurance industry, actually a lot of committees were formed through FICCI, CII and all, so many committees where standardized definitions. The insurance industry came forward and standardized definitions for the benefit of the policyholders. They said, let us most common use definitions. Even the definitions of critical illnesses to some extent have been standardized. We came out for a standardized claim form, pre-authorization forms. This is to ensure that hospitals, the providers have ease in, otherwise there are 20 insurance companies, 25 TPAs, you go to a particular hospital, which pre-auth form do you require? Okay, this particular insurance, he keeps has a problem in searching for it. Once you standardize the formats, it makes it much easier. In fact, we are looking towards electronic transfer of data with the stakeholders. We are looking to a common platform where hospitals also get linked up. It's paperless. Can you transfer the data online through that platform to the insurance companies, who can also transform authorization of the claim, etc. through. So if all this has to happen, the stakeholders have to come sit together and do it. There is investment to be done in terms of for the insurance companies, for the hospitals, for everyone, because hospitals may have to tune their or tweak with their systems to see that they are able to integrate with the common platform. And again, consumer education as well as grievance written. The insurance regulator as well as insurance companies have put in their funds to have, I think, I'm not sure whether you have seen it, but on TVs there have been ads for awareness. Now, what are the days ahead? Employers are worried about increasing healthcare costs and are forcing insurers to be risk managers than risk distributors. Insurance companies will look at cost control, which would mean utilization reviews. Cost control involves profiling of providers, doctors, and physician education programs. Hospital groups and insurers would tend to get aligned for mutual benefit. They have to come together. Hospitals would look at volumes and insurers at cost minimization. Insurers would explore pharma industry for tie-ups, would involve cost negotiation for bulk purchases. Today there are tie-ups. There are tie-ups with large hospital groups with pharma companies. Pharma companies give hospitals at discounted rates. However, that never gets passed on to the end customer. Stent manufacturing companies nearly give supply.